I'll look it up online.
Or a bit less concessions, but not much.
Are you in it?
Am I in it? No. Not as I know of.
No. Okay.
In the auditorium.
Right. Just make a point here that the camera is pointing only at the screen, so nobody else will appear on YouTube.
Good.
If I put this on YouTube, to see how it goes.
Dave, do you think we could do the line there?
You mean closing?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Presentation.
Can you speak up a bit?
Okay, I've prepared a PowerPoint presentation. Yes.
I've got a colour mic or something, Dave.
Okay, I've prepared a PowerPoint presentation on thought power. And here it comes. What about that then? Right, but it's really in three parts. The first bit is a general rundown of the various writings that have explored the power of thought. Then I have a section on the work of Annie Besant and Charles Webster Leadbeater, who worked together and did quite a lot of research into thought. And also, coming into the third part of this, Leadbeater actually produced pictures of thoughts. What thoughts look like, which is rather controversial, but I'll say something on that later. Okay, thoughts are things. Now, the phrase is normally associated with Annie Besant, but it was probably first used by Prentice Mulford of the New Thought movement in the 1880s. Now, we've got Prentice Mulford's book down in the library, Thoughts Are Things. It's written, I think, in 1889. And it reads as a surprisingly modern book, considering it's about 125 years old, 128 years old. Mm. So anyway, it's in our library, and it's now out of copyright, so you can find it online. Now, the New Thought movement really existed in the second part of the 19th century. New Thought was also known as the mental healing or mental science movement, and it was originated by a guy called Phineas Quimby, who, 1802 to 1866. Now, I'm trying to define the New Thought movement, and I've come up with this one: the study and investigation of the powers of the human mind based on the premise that it is far more powerful than generally believed. And I think that approach is actually still around. And you know, so who's seen the film The Secret?
I've seen bits of it.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So it's
the book? Is that the book?
We've seen the books as good, yeah. In the film, the idea that the mind is capable of far more than we actually think it is. Mm. And that the one guy actually says the final frontier is not space, but the human mind. So that approach, I think, is still around. Okay, here's Prentice Mulford. As his book Thoughts Are Things, that's the original copy. The one we've got in the library is a later version. As I say, it's worth having a look at. It's quite a readable book. Now, Prentice Mulford said, "Our thought is the unseen magnet, ever attracting its correspondence to things seen and tangible." And we have the origins there, I think, of the idea of the law of attraction, which has been a real buzzword in this century. If you go on to YouTube, there's page after page of clips about the law of attraction and how to work with it. Now, this is Phineas Parkhurst Quimby, 1802 to 1866. Now, he said, "Everyone is made of matter, and matter is continually going through a chemical change. This changes life, not wisdom, but life, like vegetable mineral life. Every idea is matter. So we've got the idea again, thoughts are things. This predates Prentice Morford. And so, of course, it contains life in the name of something that can be changed. Life in the name of something that can be changed. Motion or change is life. Ideas have life. A belief has life, or matter, for it can be changed. Now, all the aforesaid make up man, and all this can be changed. The idea of the power of thought, that the idea is still around. We are the sum total of what we have thought in the past and what we think now. That's the idea is there. And he died in 1866. Also, Quimby came up with something interesting. So on the subject of healing and prayer, how people have been healed by prayer. And Mary Baker Eddy of the Christian Science Movement took this on board. He postulated that it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you believe it. So, that's a blockbuster, isn't it?
If you want it to do anything, you have to believe in it.
Yes, that's right. You have to have the belief that it's possible.
Yeah.
It's, you know, balanced.
Because the more thought you put into something, the quicker it happens.
That's right. And also that people like Bell, if he did invent the telephone, and Baird with his television, they must have believed it was possible at a time when there was no firm evidence that it was.
Yeah, because it goes beyond having the idea that it's knowing that it.
Yeah, it can be.
Without a doubt, and then you can go forward with it.
Yes, like Edison's machine when he said to, speaking to that, it'll talk back to you.
Yeah.
You know.
But people have very distorted beliefs as well. You know, like people that, especially religious ones. You know, I guess America is a prime example where people say, "Oh, you know, God told me to stab all these people or whatever."
In terms of making something happen,
such as healing, and this was actually on the subject of healing and prayer. Yes, I think it doesn't matter what you believe. If you believe you can, that a particular belief system will heal you. But yes, I do agree there.
But going with what Corinne says, I mean, it's not only sort of what you believe; it's what you do with that belief.
Mm.
You know, that's another step, isn't it?
Mm.
Yeah, you can believe that it's right to kill all the puppies. But it's not right to go out and do it. But, you know, that's where your conscience, or whatever you want to call it, should step in and say, no, that's not a good idea.
Yeah, I think our choice has to be applied.
Yeah.
Yes.
Bob Proctor, though,
who's
an awful man and an awful businessman who's made lots and lots of money. He's taken a selection of memes from the ancient days and put them with a lot of sort of the New Age mind control program, and his
covering Bob Proctor in a minute.
Okay, carry on. It's just his idea. Yeah. It's quite sadistic, I find.
Yeah. Thomas J. Hudson. Now, really, the idea of conscious mind and subconscious mind goes back to him. He came up with the idea that you can actually believe something and you don't know you believe it.
Mm.
Again, that's a lot of self improvement. Gurus work with that one.
Well, meditation works with that one.
Yes.
Because once you clear your mind of what you're thinking about,
what you really
know inside can come out.
That's right, yes.
Surprising.
Clear the monkey mind, yeah.
Mm.
Thomas J. Hudson, he postulated that faith could produce psychic phenomena. He worked a lot with hypnotism as well, pioneering the field. Just to show us, go back a long way, Balthazar Gracian, he was a Jesuit priest in the 1600s, he came up with don't die of somebody else's misery. And he spoke about the ideas where the influence is on you, how it affects your thinking, and that, you know, against negativity is something that you have to distance yourself from. he was going, well, it's 500 years ago, 400 years ago. Now, I think we've all heard him, Norman Vincent Peale. Change your thoughts and change your world. Now, there's something interesting about Norman Vincent Peale. He, apparently, as a lad, was really thin, all skin and bone. And he always wanted to be bigger, put on weight and everything. And when he got to 30, he went enormous. And he says that that was because all these years of wanting to be bigger, they suddenly kicked in, and he did become bigger, and he said he just went enormous. Although he lived to be about 1993, so he lived in a normal lifespan.
So he's saying that he thought all his thoughts changed his physical.
He wanted to be a big fella. But he said he didn't anticipate being as big a fella as he became. He was scrawny, and he wanted to be bigger for years. And then suddenly he just went whoomph when he was about 30, and he went enormous. He was just overweight and everything.
But the saying is, beware what you wish for, because it will happen.
Yes, that's right. Anyway,
I'd love to know exactly what his thoughts were. Did he wake up in the morning and say, I want to be big?
Must have always been an underlying...
He thought about his subconscious, you know, all the time.
Yeah, it was just like...
Comparing himself to other
people. Things that we never achieve.
We've got a full-length picture of him in his full weight.
Well, I suppose you could be like the picture of Charles Atlas, the skinny bloke looking in the mirror, and he sees Charles Atlas. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, he got when he asked for. William Walker Atkinson. Dwarves can do the work of giants when they are transformed by the almost magic power of great mental concentration. In fact, that's something that C.W. Leadbeater talks about. Is that to work with the mind, you need to work on your concentration. Otherwise your thoughts just fly off into the white blue yonder. Richard J. Wiseman. Now, he's still alive. Born 1966. Who's seen his book, The Luck Factor? It's been even advertised on Radio 4. He has studied luck and lucky people. And he's found that lucky people actually believe they're lucky. The book's worth reading. There are characteristics and ways of thinking that lucky people have that unlucky people don't. And these are attributes you can acquire, you can work on. It's called The Luck Factor, and it's by Richard J. Wiseman.
I think it's the same thing. If you come from a very well-to-do family, as a child, you expect to be in the same category.
Yes, the expectations, yes.
Yeah, and if your parents gone to university too, you also expect to go, well, you'll probably push in that direction anyway.
Yeah, that's right.
But I think that's the expectation. Mm-hmm. You expect to be well off to.
Yeah, but it backfires on some people, doesn't it? Because they just expect it to happen without putting in any work.
Mm. And, well, I think it's that underlying belief. Obviously, for people, it does not work. Perhaps they work against it, you know. But I think on the whole, if your family is well-to-do...
You know that you can achieve that.
Yeah.
It's knowing, isn't it? Inside, you
it's
know.
It's just the expectation, and you get, somehow...
You learn too much, you never know. So academia doesn't necessarily solve a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a class-based meme that enables you to move forward.
Okay, Thich Nhat Hanh, Vietnamese Buddhist. Now, he came up with this idea of mindfulness, that if one person in a house is mindful, that has a beneficial, relaxing influence on everybody else in the house. He talks very often about how we never live in the moment. That you're making a cup of tea and you're thinking about something else. You're not thinking about making the cup of tea. But it's a sort of mindfulness, almost work as a form of meditation.
I think Maharishi said they had this experiment where in America, where thousands of people did transcendental meditation, and apparently it reduced the crime in the area.
Yeah. Well, that's possibly something to look at in the educational system. Okay, is your mate Bob Proctor?
Yeah.
Now, he postulates, and I've just taken one of his one-liners, positive thoughts a thousand times more negative than... Sorry, a thousand times more powerful than a negative thought. Okay, the idea is, yes, a positive thought is more beneficial. And as thoughts very often come back on yourself, if a good thought comes back on yourself, that's not a problem, but a bad thought comes back on yourself, or a malicious thought comes back on yourself, then that can be a problem. There was about Bob Proctor, and I'll say this about the... I'm going to say a little bit about the self-improvement and law of attraction industry, that how it's, in many ways, I think... It's gone beyond just a book like Napoleon's Hill, not Napoleon Hill's. You now have all these self-improvement and success courses that these people are selling. Right, I'll move on.
Spiritual yuppies, really.
Yeah. Okay. The modern self-improvement industry, and I think Bob Proctor is probably one of the leaders in this, and it's based on the power of belief with a new mindset and success. And no doubt about that, yes, you do need belief, and your general attitudes, you were saying about expectations, your general attitude will influence how successful you are in life. I think the equation is more complicated than that. The law of attraction industry is slightly different, I think, from the self-improvement industry. And that's based on the belief that positive thoughts attract positive circumstances. Unfortunately, I think the belief has arisen now that you only need to sit around and think about it. And although I think that there are people who exceptional people who can actually make things happen, can influence events, directly through mind power, and I think they do exist. They're probably ahead of us in their evolution, because I think that we will acquire these powers as part of our evolution. I think the whole thing is sold too simply. That it's just a question of thinking positively, and things, or your life will fall into place, and you'll be successful. And I think it's just not as simple as that.
He believes, though, that if you think negatively, and the universe doesn't care, you know, the universe just reacts to you as a generator of thought. Mm. So if you're in a negative place in your life and you're thinking negatively, the universe will give you more shit.
Well,
that's what this is based on. Mm. This whole sequence.
To some extent, that is true, that you do attract things into your life, but the extent to which you think good thoughts and good things automatically happen, and you think negative thoughts and bad things automatically happen, is overrated.
But if
it's more complicated than that.
Yeah, I agree.
It's not a lot more complicated.
No, okay.
But if the universe is treated...
things happen, if you want them to happen, they will happen.
Okay.
Does that apply to groups as well? For instance, did the Jews, in the concentration camps, did they will all that negativity on themselves? Or how
it's a difficult that one, because I think there's something to do with the karma of their ethnicity there.
About thought power attracting negativity.
Yeah, that's it's a difficult one to explain.
They've always had a certain almost a sense of that certain things should happen to them. Mm. And instead of thinking, don't know how to put it, almost as if, like the children of rich people expecting to be rich, but without doing anything about it. Jews always say, oh, we've got a land there, we're going to get back to it. But what did they do about it? They didn't do anything about it. They didn't go back to it. They just wandered around the world thinking, oh, somebody should want us back
there. Go back to it. You know, it wasn't as simple as, oh, I'm going to wander the world and not go back to my homeland.
They didn't seem to make much effort to go there.
Well, it took Adolf Weizmann to start the Zionist movement about in the 1890s. So a movement did emerge. I don't know if there are any previous movements within Judaism to go back to the homeland.
It seemed to be.
It was occupied by
everybody, the Romans, the Turks.
It's not as though they didn't want a homeland. That's what they did want was a homeland, and you get the expression the wandering Jew because they didn't have a homeland.
Yeah.
Or was it because they simply didn't dream enough about going back to the homeland? The other thing is
there's always the negative thought in
when the German government started to hunt the Jews, is it not possible that a lot of the Jews then they feared for their life? And because there must have been a lot of Jews who actually got away and got to America somewhere.
Some did, yes.
In time. But simple hint that fear, because actually then brought them into a concentration camp instead of out of the country. As the Bible says, I fear has happened.
Possibly, and I also feel with Judaism, there is possibly the creation of the vengeful God of the Old Testament. and that's influenced their thinking.
I mean, that's right, that's a belief, so they believe that what's happening.
Well, their God is not quite the caring God of Christianity. They still adhere to the vengeful God of the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm. And but that vengeful God said that you are the chosen people and I will look after you and, you know, you will be able to defeat everyone around you.
I don't think he quite said that. I think he said that they must go through certain struggles and that. I don't think he offered, he guaranteed them an easy time.
I'd have to do some further
Bible study on that one.
All the battles they did have, it was God saying to them, you know, God was on their side, you are the chosen people, and you will be able to defeat these people. That happened with several of the tribes when they're, you know, wandering around.
They do have the belief that God spoke only to them. I don't know if any other ethnic group actually has that.
I think whoever set the karma exams has got us in a moronic game, and they are basically our enemy. And that fits into the demiurge in the Gnostics, where the god is the false god, the god that is controlling this particular dimension, you know, samsara, maya, the matrix, whatever you want to call it, is basically a sadistic god.
Well, the Cathars believe something similar, I understand,
Where are they today?
Yeah, that's right.
But since we are learning here that the mind is very powerful, so when we are saying that we rely upon God, we are actually giving away our power to something.
That's true. And I think
something you can't.
Pardon?
Yeah, I think that's where the New Thought movement differs from religion, is that the New Thought movement, you invoke something, you don't pray for it. Basically, and I think that again with the self-improvement movement, you make it happen. It's a thing. I work for an American company and used to have an evaluation on a fairly regular basis, and one of the things in the evaluation was the ability to make things happen. And it's something very much, I think, that's come up through the New Thought movement, that you don't just think about it, you don't just you don't just learn, you don't just study, but you use the ideas and you make things happen. And I think we've all known people who've got enough diplomas and degrees to sink a battleship, but they can't make anything happen in their life. I think we've all come across people like that. Anyway, back to the subject. Both the self-improvement and law of attraction industries are dominated by people who make money by telling people how to make money. And I've had a problem with this for years, that somebody comes on and says, how are you going to make all this money? But they make their money by running courses and selling books on how to be positive and make a load of money. You don't get somebody...
But then they're showing you that, aren't they?
Yes.
They're actually showing you by doing it.
Yeah, that you make the money by
telling people what to do. Yeah, write a book about it.
But they could be sitting in some bed sitting online, couldn't they? Completely broke.
Yes, they could be. They could be, yes. Yes. Sure,
thank you.
I went to a motivational
It's happening
talk
like
I
reckon.
That.
It's so big now, this movement.
Yeah, I went to a motivational talk like that, and I remember the guy saying, you won't make money sitting around meditating.
Mm.
And it always stuck in my head.
Yes.
You know, it was so money focused.
Yeah.
It was like an NLP type.
Yeah.
You know, and it was just like...
But is everybody who went on that course now a millionaire?
Sorry?
Is everybody who went on that course now a millionaire?
Well, they claim to be millionaires. It was all very American focused, and money is the god and all that sort of stuff, really.
Yeah.
So
I think that's where they go wrong, you know, that they do focus a lot on money.
Mm.
Mm.
I mean, money is just a byproduct, just a necessity, like having water. You don't have to have masses of money to be happy.
But
it's the being happy that matters.
Yeah. But what I'm saying is there's a lot of people making a lot of money out of selling these positive books.
It's a whole industry.
And really, you know, they're ignoring the spiritual side, they're ignoring...
Oh, yeah,
and we're reading these books and thinking, oh, wow, these are people have made money, but maybe they're not all that happy and they haven't got their spiritual side and...
They're preying on desperate people.
But where they are in their personal spiritual development, that may be adequate for them.
Maybe that's as far as they've got.
You know, they might be quite happy with that. You know, perhaps for people that come to the Theosophical Society, that isn't enough. So it depends where you are in your spiritual evolution, I think. Some people are just happy to have a load of money and sit at home counting it.
And they don't understand the law of non-attachment.
No, that's right. So perhaps there's things, you go from life to life, you go through certain things, and having loads of money and counting it is one of them. Possibly.
It's interesting they talk about money, they don't actually talk about success.
Yeah.
Mm. The two have become more or less the same thing, and I think that's come more from the American way of thinking. If you're so smart, why aren't you rich?
Yeah.
You know, I think there's such
judged
by how much money you've got. Other societies judge people differently.
Happy and contented and finding the things you need to do in life.
Mm. Yes.
The money to go with it.
Okay.
The Tao says that having a lot of money and saying that you have a lot of money, it's not the having a lot of money that matters. It's saying or showing that you have a lot of money is sinful, in that it causes other people to become jealous and envious, and even to make some people, you know, turns them into burglars and cheats and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have, you know, great financial success, hide it.
Well, I think people who have great financial success become paranoid, and that's why they have all these gated communities now in America.
Right.
And America.
I'd love to live in a gated
community. There is something actually...
But if nobody knew they had it, they could just walk around like everybody else.
That's just riding around on your bike and you got
just
no
don't
money.
Spend any of it.
Yeah, never spend any of it. Got loads of money in the bank, yes.
The problem is a lot of people who've got money are corrupt.
Yeah.
And it's not just the wealth and the position and the family they're from. It's that it's come about through corruption.
Yeah.
Well, through using people in very negative ways.
Yeah,
that's all that.
Yeah, flesh and blood rule this dimension.
Thoughts are things, okay. Although the phrase does not appear to have been originally theirs, Annie Besant and C.W. Leadbeater, big names in the Theosophical movement, developed and elaborated on this concept by applying theosophical principles and some ideas of their own. Now here we are, Annie Besant, C.W. Leadbeater, they are walking down the street in about 1925. Mm-hmm. That was actually, that period, the early 20s, was actually a golden age for the Theosophical Society, which has failed since then to recreate. And this is from Leadbeater's book, The Power and Use of Thought. There are two main books. This is actually only a pamphlet, Power and Use of Thought, and another book called Thought Forms by Annie Besant and C.W. Leadbeater. Now this is, Leadbeater says, of the general nature of the unseen world, I've written elsewhere, for the moment, let us concentrate our attention on one of its most striking characteristics, the ready response of the finer types of matter of which it is constructed to the influences of human thought and emotion. Well, that's, Leadbeater was writing this, actually wrote this in 1911, and something very similar turned up in The Secret, to do with the emotion, with an emotional-based universe and that. Now, Besant and Leadbeater said that a thought produces four effects. Now, before we go any further, because people are probably not familiar with this, the concept of the mental body. We, in Theosophy, we have the constitution of man, which means that we're composed of several invisible principles. So, Iris, are you familiar with any of this?
Yeah, I think so, maybe.
Okay. Yeah, that's all right. If you're familiar with it, I'll rush through it. Otherwise, I can get out and do a presentation on it.
Oh, right. No, yeah, go for it quickly.
Yeah, okay.
Fine. Yeah, don't worry.
Okay. You're up for the mental body, aren't you?
I'm pretty cerebral.
Okay. We've composed several invisible principles. Now, I'll just mention mental body. I'll go on to the constitution of man in a minute. Just as we all have a physical body to function on the physical plane of nature, we have a mental body to enable us to function on the plane of thought or the mental plane of nature. Now, there we have a picture of the mental body generating thought, which is a fairly obvious statement here. In addition to that, and mention this, the evolution of mind, Theosophy generally postulates, in our current period of evolution, we are intended to develop our mental body, the thought processes, the mind. That is what we are developing in our current phase of evolution. And it's brought us a long way, if you look at our technology. In fact, it's also brought us a long way. We could be heading for disaster, because at one time we thought our technology was the answer to everything, and we could well basically decide the planet unfit for habitation, or also too many people on the planet. And that's all a result of our mind power. But okay, we may have to go through this as part of our evolution. Okay, a thought produces four effects. One, it creates habit. An oft-repeated vibration, and point to Leadbeater, all thought is vibration. I think that's that idea of thought being vibration, positive vibration, negative vibration. That comes up quite a lot in New Thought or any self-improvement book, the idea of vibration. And it renders the mental body more amenable to that vibration. So I think that's why possibly negative people find it very difficult to become positive. It's a bit like a flywheel spinning in one direction. And if you want it to go the other way, you can't just send it the other way. You have to stop the flywheel and then start it up in the opposite direction.
Don't you need to be both to maintain the balance?
I'm not sure. I think people have a basal level of optimism, and sometimes they're above it and sometimes they're below it. And people who, I think, enjoy negativity, and there are people who enjoy negativity, this is where people who enjoy ill health, because there's a payoff for not being well. There's a lot of advantages in not being well for some people. then it's very difficult to suddenly turn it round and go the other way. As you go down one road, you turn back and go down another road, it's more difficult. But I agree, if you're neither positive nor negative, then you have it. It's easy to make that decision that you'll be positive. And
I suppose it's how each state is perceived by another individual, according to their belief system.
That's true. Well, some people refer to being negative as being realistic. So yes, you could rationalise it. I'm a really negative person, but I'm realistic.
But that's only about negativity.
That's true.
It's sort of kicking a dog for no reason and kicking because it's trying to bite your leg.
What?
A bit esoteric, that was it.
Yeah, but what are you
well,
saying?
If you kick a dog, it's negative, if it's not doing anything to you. But if you kick a dog that's trying to bite your leg, it might be perceived as negativity by some people, but really you're just protecting yourself.
Yeah.
But you had a business reason.
Pretty bad
doing
analogy,
it.
Really.
Had a business reason.
No, it wasn't.
I mean, neither is a particularly good thing, but I do. People that kick dogs for no reason really have a negativity problem, I think.
You've got to kick those even lowy dogs.
Yeah, that's true.
What you're talking about is defending yourself. Say, if you were in a fight and you're defending yourself, is that a negative thing? Yeah. Is the attacker seen as being negative?
But there are more ways than one than of defending yourself, aren't they? You don't have to kick the dog. You can move away from the dog.
But if it's already got your leg.
Well, you can bear the pain. You can just get down there and talk to it.
They're talking more about sort of motivational tendencies, general motivational tendencies, in terms of positivity or negativity. Like.
Well, there are people who suffer from can't be asked syndrome, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Anyway, back to the repeated vibration.
Can I just ask a question, though? Did any of these writers talk about mental health, and how would, say, for instance, someone with schizophrenia or bipolar or
I haven't covered that in this talk.
Did any of them speak about that, and what sort of vibrations they bring?
No, I haven't covered that. They didn't understand that much about it back then. Yeah.
That's a good point, though.
They didn't have the words for it.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, it's relevant to what we're discussing at the moment.
Yeah,
if we're talking about thoughts creating vibrations, then you need to...
Well, I would say that anything to do with mental illness is normally disharmonious. Mm-hmm. And somebody who is disturbed in their thinking, in their thought processes, or disconnected, can have a similar effect on the people around them.
A disturbing effect
on the people around them.
But a lot of mental illness, people call it mental illness because it seems to come out of your head, but it is a physical thing because processes not working.
Yes, that's right.
In your mind, that is why they're able to have drugs to balance things out.
Yeah, but some things are biological, i.e. these effects are in your brain. There's some brain abnormality, if you like. So no matter how people, they wouldn't be able to have the consciousness to think positively or
the
universe would punish them for that.
Yeah.
Because the universe punishes people who don't think positively all the time.
This is what the secret says. It may be a karmic effect of.
But who wrote the karma exams, Dave?
What?
Who wrote the karma exams and why have they got us in this game? You know?
Well, okay, I postulate that there is a law of cause and effect passing from one life to the next. And that what we do in each life affects the sort of people we are, not just what happens to us, but the sort of people we are in future lives. And it may be, and also it's based on what we need to learn for our spiritual development. So there may be that you need to go through a life as an alcoholic or somebody with a mental health problem.
So you spend your whole life in a depressed state, attracting negative energy, and it gets worse. So who's,
well,
you know,
yes, exactly.
What force is, you know, I think there's all these ideas about karma and stuff that are just accepted. And I think they need, you know, the mystery sphere needs to be burnt down.
But depression mainly is an imbalance. Mm.
But then you've got all these normal people in society.
Mm?
We've got the normal versus the weird, haven't we? And a lot of people who are considered weird would be considered mentally ill by the establishment of drug companies. I mean, I haven't told them Asperger's recently.
Well, the idea that we've changed the definition of mental illness several times, even in the last 100 years. As to what is considered to be mental illness, certainly in this country, mental health has changed several times, and certainly in the Middle Ages, hearing voices was not the problem as it is now.
No.
And there may be people who are considered mentally ill actually have psychic faculties that they can't control.
And Jung's work with schizophrenia as well,
that's
and
right,
the
yeah.
arts and all that sort of stuff.
But as far as this talks concerned, I'm dealing with people who whose thought processes are functioning normally and what we would call rationally. To examine from the esoteric point of view, people what we consider to have mental health problems, from the theosophical point of view, yes, I think that is something that we could look at. I'm not very familiar, though, with mental illness. Possibly to, I'm not really qualified, but I would say there are a number of things that are considered to be mental illness relate to people who can contact other planes, have visions of other planes of nature, have psychic clairvoyance, you know, that sort of thing, and they can't handle it.
So they may be in beyond a vision quest to become a shaman,
possibly
a wounded healer, but society would say that was wrong. And if you say to them it's a healthy reaction to a sick society, that society would tell you you were being negative.
Yeah. In another society, they may be quite acceptable.
Yeah.
So that's quite a difficult subject.
But the indigenous people have been sort of wiped out, haven't they? Perhaps purposely, by some sort of, to quite
that,
a large extent.
That has been happening for about nearly 20,000 years. That once we had the agrarian revolution, hunter-gatherer man progressively has been pushed out.
But they were killing all the buffalo, weren't they? They were going out and killing them all. It seemed to be a holocaust.
That's what was done to the American Indians, yeah.
It was sort of done to the Welsh on one level as well.
Okay.
that's a little larded.
Okay, back to the subject.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, creates habit that once you're vibrating in a particular way, then that becomes you more. It's how you work. It's how your mind is working. Now, habit. A sufficiently strong thought may, for the moment, have the whole of the matter of the mental body swinging at the same rate. I don't know if it's swinging. You got this in 1911. And every time that happens, it is a little easier for it to happen again. A habit of vibration at that rate is being set up in the mental body, so the man will readily repeat that particular thought. It's a step to the obvious, actually, but yeah. Okay. Secondly, a vibration pertaining to the lower mental levels, and led me to divided the mental body into three higher levels that aspire towards the spiritual, and three lower levels which resonate with the emotional. A vibration pertaining to the lower mental levels can to a certain extent produce sympathetic vibration in the astral lower octave, is called it there, body, as well as the causal body, that's the higher, the body, that's the amalgam of the bodies above the mental body. Only unselfish and loving thoughts can even draw the power of the buddhic levels, the level above. So, that's basically the resonate at either a higher or a lower level on in the constitution of man. Right, a vibration generates thoughts of the same type in the recipient's mental body. So, if say I have a particular thought at this end of the room, then that in a way will resonate produce a similar thought in everybody else, in theory. Although we're now in a discussion, aren't we? So we're all working to our own agendas. But the idea that one person has the idea, then that idea is out there to be picked up of it. The resonance is out there to be picked up by somebody else. And a thought form closing the living matter of the elemental essence and of the mental and astral planes becomes an elemental. And I'll talk about elementals in a few minutes, because sometimes they can clear off on their own and do their own thing. It reproduces in the recipient not just the same kind of thought, but exactly the same thought. Now, let's get hinting here at telepathy. And also that the thoughts are out there. This is something that's come up with Newton and Leibniz worked on exactly the same thing, but they never met. They're working at the same time, more or less the same thing. And this has happened with scientific breakthroughs, that they've occurred different parts of the world with people working completely separately with no knowledge of each other. So like the ideas are out there.
And you often find that books are published and then you get three or four books of the same subject coming out.
That's right.
Almost together.
Yeah, there's something.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
And it happens. I belong to a writing circle and quite often we can come up with ideas, similar ideas.
I do think we read each other's thoughts.
Mm. Okay, I've got the seven principles here. At the top, the seven principles of man, the Atma, the peace of God in everybody, the divine spark, the Buddhic principle, which is the vehicle for the divine spark, and the two combined together give us our individual spiritual entity, which continues from life to life, or sometimes referred to as a reincarnating ego when it's combined with an element of the higher mind. The manus, the mind, and that's divided into higher and lower, although there is really only one mind, but certainly Leadbeater said that the three higher levels of the mind aspire upwards and the four lower levels aspire downwards. The karma, they call it the animal soul here, and I don't think that is a good description. That is our desire body. I prefer to use the term desire body. Primordial life energy.
Excuse me.
The astral body, which is a sort of template for the physical self. That's how, even though you sort of age over the years, you look in the mirror and you can still recognise yourself. And the physical body. Okay, I won't spend too much time on this. Now, spiritual thoughts and spiritual aspirations are really a combination of the Buddhic principle with the higher mind. And the desire-driven thoughts, of which most of our thoughts are desire-driven thoughts, I think, is the lower mind and the desire body. I've mentioned it here, let me divide the mental body to seven levels, three higher and four lower. All bodies of the human constitution have seven subdivisions. This comes from the power and use of thought. Now then, Leadbeater postulates that in most people the higher levels of the mental body are not fully developed. That fits in with the theosophical view that our mind is evolving in this era. That's what we're doing at the moment. And we've still some way to go. I think what has happened, our rational and emotional thinking processes have worked wonders and given us a great deal. But we're without the higher levels, we're running into trouble. Now, higher levels of thought are developed by inner work in this life or in previous lives. And I think any effort to be selfless, be spiritual, anything like that, is never wasted. And even if you don't see direct benefit in this life, there will be benefits in future lives. So no, nothing's wasted. Now, this is from Leadbeater. Each man as he moves through life produces three classes of thought forms. Those which shoot straight out away from him, aiming at a definite object, that's his specific thoughts. Those which hover around him and follow him wherever he goes, I think that's more your general attitudes to life. And those which he leaves behind him is a sort of trail which marks his route. These are your sort of thoughts that just dissipate. And I think this model he's got is a bit too simple, but I think that it's basically true that a lot of your thoughts just drift off. They have no real consequence or importance, and they just drift off. They're not strong enough or specific enough. And that you do have general thoughts that you're sort of innate thinking processes that produce some thoughts that are just for yourself, and it's sort of got to make up sort of who you are and what you are. That's basically saying the same thing. Destination back to oneself or not directed. Okay, move on. Now, the emotionally dominated thoughts, and I think it's very likely to be emotionally dominated. It's difficult to have a non-emotionally dominated thought other than a spiritual thought. When a man's energy flows outwards towards external objects of desire, it is occupied in passional and emotional activities. This energy works in a less subtle order of matter than the mental, in that of the astral world. So emotion, yeah, and I think you've possibly come across this, where somebody comes into a room and they're quite angry, and you can pick up their anger even before they've opened their mouths. I think that's just there. Now, the desire body, and I've been bonnet about this one, the desire body gets a hard time in lots of esoteric literature, and I think this is unwarranted. excessive negation of your desire principle, like just denying your emotions or that, doesn't in itself lead to spiritual development. Just as sort of like...
that's just negative, isn't it?
Yeah,
just only positive things that work.
Yeah, that's right. It's like sort of, I don't drink, I don't smoke, therefore I'm a more spiritual person or something. It is, doesn't work like that. In fact, Buddha Gautama Siddhartha said this, you can be too ascetic, you know, as an end in itself. And it will make it difficult to lead a normal life. Now, all positive thinking in the material domain relies on the desire principle, I think.
Why?
There has to be, I'm going to go through this quite a lot of detail, there has to be a level of motivation that you have to want to do something. And it's not always easy to stay positive. Okay. Now, letting that on the other hand, always giving in to desire will give you a weak will, which will be reinforced in the next incarnation. So I do think it's not a good idea just to give in to desire all the time. Well, here we are. So two characters from 300 years in the future. Okay, it's difficult to have a thought completely without emotion. Now, Spock is saying that's completely illogical, Captain. Well, that's what he would say, because that's his act. His thoughts are without emotion. But there's more to say on Spock in a minute. The power of emotion to dominate can become a problem. But you need emotion to function in the world, and there are, however, some aspects of emotion you really need to control. Right. Here we have. What's his name?
Jones
out of Dad's Army. Don't panic, don't panic. And he cannot control his fear and nervousness, and it prevents him from functioning effectively. Because the first thing, if you've got a bit of a crisis, the last thing you want is somebody running around shouting, "Don't panic, don't panic."
It's post-traumatic stress disorder, isn't it? From when he was fighting the fuzzy wuzzies.
Well, that's right. He's clearly got a lot of history to him, Jones. But I think it's a general it gets too much through sometimes and it shows, but yeah. Okay, has Mr. Greedy go shopping? So that, yeah, there's some people just kind of like that. I have trouble sitting out the chip shop. And some people can't control their anger. And I'm sure we've all worked with people like that. Okay. You function without a desire body, Mr. Spock. Okay. Now, Mr. Spock says, also completely illogical, Captain. Where do I get my motivation to live my life? Can motivation exist without desire or other emotional driving force?
What do you think?
What do I think? I think that there has to be a level of desire just to keep yourself going in life, that you want to go on living. And you want to, not just you want to go on living, because then you could just sit, as you said, sit in a bed, sit and you know, eat chips. There's a desire to be the sort of person that you are, to socialise as you do, and the things that you do want, you do the things that you do. There has to be a level of underlying level of motivation based on desire in order for you to do those things. Okay. Even the will to survive comes from desire. And can you really rise to a senior position in Starship Command?
Edith wanted to say something.
Oh, sorry.
I think desires are only bad. If you get a bad desire, you should not act on it. It's depending on your... I don't think we can live without desire. But...
Yeah.
But we should not act on desires.
Yes, okay.
Working against us. Bad diet, whatever.
Yeah, I think
sitting in the bed, sitting in chips. That's weird. But Spock may be motivated by a different desire, and there are many versions of desire, aren't there?
Yeah. Well, motivation. I mean, from
the
other
side,
you can
well.
Be motivated by anger. Welcome to the sanatorium. You can be motivated by anger. You can be motivated by hatred. But it's still
desire.
It's still desire.
Desire expects a result.
Yeah.
I don't like the use of desire in that sense. Even the will to survive comes from desire.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just feel hungry, and it's not a desire to eat. It's just. You know, like it's sort of more like an animal instinct that you
want to. Okay, but
there are certain things that aren't desires; that they're just sort of basic.
But instinct is.
And sometimes you can't keep your eyes open, so you need
sleep.
It's not a desire for sleep; it's just that you can't keep your eyes open. So I don't like the use of that word desire in that sentence.
It's difficult to find another word. That
motivation.
I mean, okay, you could say you're motivated by actual biological need, like I don't want a bag of chips, but I have to have one because it's good for me.
Well, that vitamin C.
Vitamin C, yes. The plenty of vitamin C chips.
I think there's a distinction between needs. You know, like you need to sleep, you need to eat, and wants, which are more like desire.
Yeah.
You know, things that you don't really need, but things that you want.
I still think that in order to carry on living, you need a level of desire. But yes, I do agree, you have underlying that. You have to perform certain things, like eat, sleep, drink, yeah. The idea that some people just give up on life or lose the will to live. And some people have starved themselves to death as a form of suicide.
Mm.
And partners die, don't they, sometimes?
Sorry?
If somebody dies,
yeah,
it's clear close to you
soon after. Yeah. That's happened a lot. But I would maintain that Spock, despite functioning without an emotional body, has become a senior officer in Starship Command and did have but certainly highly motivated to do that.
Unless he was just pushed into it. Well, you've heard the expression.
Mm-hmm.
Some people have
greatness thrust upon them. Yeah.
Another one.
Achieve greatness and something.
He wasn't
great.
Real,
though. Yeah, that's
it. Really, he wasn't real, Scott.
He wasn't real.
You telling me he's not real?
He's not real.
You told me this about Neil out of the Young Ones the other week.
It's so easy to get sidetracked in this.
Yeah, that's
it.
Yeah.
But then there's the idea that Gene Rodenbury was actually an abductee, and he's just giving us a lot of information to prepare us for a future in space.
Yes.
So these entities are aliens.
Well,
the one
encouraging thing about all this is that in 300 years' time, everybody except the Klingons will speak English. That's just amazing.
Or Mandarin.
What?
Mandarin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's marvellous that everywhere they landed spoke English.
Yes.
But isn't Spock based on, I would say he's based on a high-functioning autistic person who has difficulty with their emotions. I think he's a fictional character.
Just see what comes in a minute, yeah. Okay. So he's admitting, yes, you must have a level of desire to get up in the morning. And he says, yes, and then I treat life as algebra and stay on dating websites. Can you imagine getting Spock on a dating website later? But think about it. Spock's wedding night. That'd be a good one, wouldn't it? Right. Mr. Spock represents somebody who can make a complete separation between his thinking and emotional principles. A real Mr. Spock would be considered socially dysfunctional and damaged. I think that answers your question. you can't operate like that.
Well, I don't know. We live in a very left brain.
Mm.
I don't know whether you've seen the Big Bang Theory.
I have seen it, yes.
Yeah, where they're all scientists and...
Yeah, and they're socially dysfunctional, yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Yes, they've taken that idea of the brilliant nuclear physicist who can't tie his shoelaces. And they've made a whole sitcom on people who are like that, yeah.
And there's five of them that are like that, and they're all astronauts and microbiologists and physicists.
There is a story, you know, have you ever heard of the South Thule incident, 1953? In 1950, there's an island in the South Atlantic called South Thule. Nobody knows where it is, no one's ever been there. But in 1953, it had a naval supply depot. It's a British Antarctic territory. Anyway, 1953, the Argentinian Navy landed and took British naval personnel prisoner. And Churchill was Prime Minister then, and he wasn't having it, and he sent the fleet, at which the Argentinians caved in and said it was a mistake, we were on manoeuvres, you can't get the staff. But on the island, there was a colony, I believe, of scientists, all of whom were completely mad. They never bothered with them. They were all completely, they'd been cut off. Because in those days, I mean, you would get your ship down there, and there wouldn't be another ship back for about another 3 years or something. And they'd all sort of...
There's always been stories of nutty professors, haven't there?
Oh, yeah.
People get to a level of scientific intelligence, and sticking to scientific, because that's what we were talking about. Because their brains work in that way, the rest of us think of them as nutty.
Yeah.
They're not, they're just super intelligent.
That's right, yeah.
But nobody likes to admit that somebody else is super intelligent.
That's right, the absent mind of professors.
And they don't have to.
I think
they're
recognising it now, because I think even people like Alan Turing, I think, he was probably autistic or Asperger's or something
like that. They said it about L.S. Lowry as well.
Yeah,
that's right. There was something,
more
there was a disconnect or a dysfunction there. Well, Einstein rang the university.
No, you call it a dysfunction. I think it's brilliant.
Oh,
right,
very
they nice. Can be like that.
Yeah,
but
they can get places that we cannot.
That's true. Einstein could. Yes.
Can I just ask a quick question before we go on? In what way were they mad? These people that have
been. Well, this question again. How we define people who do not conform to the behaviour patterns of our society, and some we either class them as criminal or as mad. I mean, in Russia under communism, people who didn't agree criticised the system were classed as mentally ill.
It's still like that
in Russia.
In America, there's a lot of new things happening in psychology that if you believe in esoteric ideas or UFOs or whatever, you're mentally ill. There is actually a...
Oh,
and Lauren Hill from the Fugees was putting out a lot of ideas. You know, I'm not a fan of the Fugees, I don't know much of the music. And she was put under house arrest about 3 years ago to be re-educated. Mm. And that was hashtag, kept quiet. But that did happen. Sorry?
She was done for something like a 20 million in unpaid taxes as well.
Right. Mm. I didn't know that bit.
Yeah. So it's sort of...
I'm just looking at... Yeah. Yeah, I could be wrong then, but there seems to be something going on if you look at certain psychological definitions of people.
But I think when
the mass mental lobotomy of the population via big pharma drugs.
But I think that you have the people that, and we call them Asperger's or autistic or whatever, but and then you get the savant side of them. Mm. Perhaps because they're that clever at that point, they don't need to be bothered with how to tie your shoelaces.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
I think
they've got better things to think about.
Yes.
I think on an emotional level, that's the sacrifice that's paid.
Yeah.
On an emotional level, and I think Oliver Sacks is absolutely brilliant.
Oh, he's wonderful.
Bringing out, you know, that people with mental health problems actually have this brilliant part to them that. Yeah.
Well, I've been told I'm Asperger's, as I keep on saying, but I think it's bullshit. And there is the concept, the starseed concept, which has been hijacked by the new age, that a lot of people who are behaving outside the model of consensus behaviour are starseeds. So they're basically like bodhisattvas, aliens that have incarnated on Earth to help with the shift. And to stop the control that's going on and reactivate the third eye so we can become spiritual and truly spiritual and move forward finally into some better earth.
Yeah, I think in time to come, I think this idea of normal won't exist. Because I don't think anyone is normal. It's just everyone is on a spectrum.
I think the point I'm making is they're doing it because they can... They can manipulate these people and they can shut them down with drugs.
Yeah. Mm. Can anybody tell me how the power of concentration is measured?
Well, right.
Yeah, that's true. Okay.
That's a good
one. Concentration, right.
How is it measured?
That's a very good point.
Everybody being strong and not weak or whatever. How is it measured?
I would have thought it would be a very subjective sort of thing.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You can only know yourself.
Yeah.
As just as you can only really know yourself what you're thinking, or whether you're having a strong thought or a weak thought or an important thought or a trivial thought or an emotional thought. You can only really know that yourself. Okay, Leadbeater was a big fan of concentration, and he saw this as one of the driving powers behind the power of thought. Developing the mind is aided by developing the power of concentration, and it facilitates inner work and higher spiritual thought. That you have a choice and you need to work on it, and this normally brings the emotions under control in most circumstances if you can concentrate. If you can't concentrate, then you're adrift really. There has to be some point at which you can hold the line.
But how do you know where the point is, like Howard said? How do you...
You can only know that yourself, and that probably changes with time. But yes, I do agree, there's no... You can't... Okay, there are these exercises you can do in concentration, of looking at a pencil and studying it and things like that. But on the whole, you can only really assess these things. These are purely subjective, as you said, and you can only assess these things yourself. Go on, Edith, you can say...
If you are emotionally upset, then obviously it's very difficult to concentrate.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So then I think one has to deal with those emotions first and they usually sit in a body at one point.
Yeah.
And that, according to Krishnamurti, is one way of meditating on that pain in the body to alleviate it.
Yes, you have to concentrate on what is happening.
Yeah.
And that's being in the moment,
just
isn't it?
Yeah. Your mind
that's right.
With that.
Yeah.
But if you're upset and you're sitting in a meeting or whatever you are, your mind will...
It can't do it.
Yeah.
Moving on.
But how is you measure how strong it is? You can only measure, I suppose, in how strong it is how much do you remember if you've seen that film, if you've been in the meeting, if how much do you remember of that talk or whatever.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose that would be the only way you could actually measure it.
And people are all at different levels of controlling their emotions and their concentration.
Well,
anyway.
The thing is,
and
you
it depends on the subject. You might be able to read a book, but you have no interest in what's on the telly or,
you know,
sort of different things that...
It doesn't
you need to focus on
you.
You.
It doesn't grab you.
Are you talking more about the ability to apply concentration?
Yes.
Rather than
it
in general, yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Some people just can't concentrate, you know, and it's something possibly need to work on. Term and dilation, that's... Leadbeater did compare thought patterns, vibrations to radio waves. That's something that's been used a lot by writers since. Now, thought produces a decided effect along lines broadly similar to its own. A spiritual thought will uplift someone with no spiritual development. He believed.
How do you know that?
Well, this is the Leadbeater postulated this, that somebody with, and Thich Nhat Hanh follows the same idea, that someone who is spiritual will have that spiritual effect on people around them.
How
it's
do we know
problem.
Though?
It's probably postulated, it's no different consideration, you don't have to accept it.
I'm just wondering why they... how they thought you could tell.
Mm. Well, the answer is the effect might be not measurable, but it may be there.
So, are we actually saying if you've got if a thought uplifts you, then it's a spiritual thought?
No, it could be a positive
not.
Thought. It could be a positive thought, but he's referring here to a spiritual thought.
Perhaps, I have the difficulty that he what exactly is this spiritual thought?
I cannot see that there is a spiritual thought and one that is not. Because if we are in evolution and we are all learning, then everything will have to be spiritual.
Well, we all have the potential for spiritual thought, but there are people who have selfless and aspirational thought, you know, towards spirituality, and those would be different from emotionally driven thoughts, which would really come from the lower part of the mental body. So we're talking higher spiritual thinking.
But as we are spiritual beings going through an earthly experience, surely all our thoughts are spiritual.
No.
Some of them will be grounded
in the physical world, I think. We're all capable of spiritual thought, but we don't always have them.
No.
As I see it, we're in physical bodies, we're doing physical things, and we'll have physical thoughts that have no... spiritual basis, I think. Okay. That's my strongest
such as?
Well, just wanting to own a bigger car than your neighbours, because it's just to show them.
Oh, that comes in, yes.
You know, that sort of thing.
Indians.
I can't see that. Because what I'm picking up is that eventually... in order to get off this roundabout, we've got to transcend the mind.
Yes. And it's going to take a lot longer with some people than it is with others.
Pardon?
Some people have got a lot farther to go than others.
So, therefore, I think all thoughts will have to be spiritual?
Eventually, yes. As we evolve, but they're not at the moment. No, it's something we have to rise out of the physical. That is the Virgil said something about that is the task, that is the labour, you know. Mm-hmm. Easy as the descent into the abyss, it's getting out again. Okay, let me decide. So, ready response to the finer types of matter, the influences of human thought and emotion. Now, in the Middle Ages, that would have been called sorcery. And Leadbeater, I think, makes a point here about some of the old traditions, you know, still hold up. Power of a thought. So, who remembers Charles Atlas? Now, the distance covered by a thought and the strength and persistence with which it influences mental bodies of others depend upon the strength and clearness of the original thought. I think that's fairly obvious, actually, that if you are, again, with the element of concentration, the power of the thought, if it's even if it's coming from a very low level of physicality, and it's to do with hatred or anger, it is still a powerful thought. And this is something, I'm going to say something on this. Powerful thoughts handled with care. Powerful thoughts can take on a life of their own. Positive thoughts, that's not a problem. But extreme anger and long-standing animosity, this can come back on yourself. It's negative, karmic. I know you don't like karma, but it has, you know,
karmic. Just questioning what karma really is.
Yeah, okay. Now, once a thought becomes an entity in its own right, you've lost control of it. Thoughts, and Dion Fortune is the person to read on this, the idea of getting really angry and creating a malevolent thought that takes off on its own and has a life of its own and actually acquires further energy from elsewhere and almost becomes an elemental. In extreme cases, you can create an elemental that can come back and haunt you in a future life. But you've really got to go at it to do that. But it is, that is possible. Malicious thoughts come back on the originator and have a negative karmic effect. And you could, in theory, yes, if you were very negative, you could create elementals that could come back on you even in a future life.
But elementals are not all bad, they're what you create.
That's true, but I'm talking about negative thought elementals here. Mm. But you can create a good elemental, that's not to worry about, is it? I've not spent as much time on those.
Don't realise.
Okay, mind over matter. Now, this is something I've had with the secret, the idea that you can just influence events by positive thinking. Yes, you can have an influence. But the idea of, as we're talking about, say, sorcery, mind over matter, and I think the power is latent within all of us, and it will manifest at a later stage of our evolution, that the mind will become more powerful. And there are some people already who have this mind over matter power, and there have been people in history who had it, the ability to influence events with mind power. Now, there's people who can visualise parking spaces, and when they get there, there's a parking space. That's big on the secret, and I think that's possible to... You know, there are people that can do this.
You're always the first in the new shopping queue.
Sorry?
You're always the first in the new shopping queue when the lady comes to the teller.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you just visualise it. Yes, and it happens.
Intuitively, you know what the bargains are.
Yeah, that's true. I think that is possible. That is something that we will evolve into. And I think we all have it a bit. You have it a little bit. But it possibly, with considerable inner work, you could develop it more. But I think it's scheduled to kick in later in our evolution.
Now, the thing is, if we develop the mind to be even stronger, as you're saying, that is our evolution, but will we then get off this roundabout?
No, you would still have a choice. You would still have the choice to be positive or negative.
Bigger whatever.
No, you would still have the choice to be more spiritual or more physical, even if we
the idea is that, of course, it's not Christianity, but to Buddhism and Hinduism is to get off this roundabout.
Yeah.
Within this current cosmic era,
if you want to drink from the other side,
we will evolve beyond our current period of evolution. And getting off the roundabout is actually evolving beyond the need to engage in the cycle of death and rebirth in our current period of evolution. But there are, if we talk in terms of rounds and races, we have two, in the current cosmic era, we have two more mass reincarnations of humanity, root races, to come. Once we've completed the current one, and we will evolve within our current root race beyond the need to engage in the cycle of death and rebirth, and then we will then move on to a future root race, and we altogether go through 49 phases of evolution during the planet of Manvantara, of which we're halfway through. So yes, the idea that we get off the roundabout is correct, that we evolve beyond our current situation, but the idea that we can retire from the game after that, sorry. Okay, is that, everyone happy with that one?
Mm. Well, why the wheel?
How do we really know?
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I was just thinking about this thought power, mind over matter, influencing events, and people like Darren Brown and David Blaine, and I've looked at some of the stuff that they do, and being able to influence a whole audience, and they're said to be illusionists. But when you look at the stuff that they do, it's just incredible, and you just think, how on earth? Because they do it out in the streets, and I've spoken to people, and they say, well, they're not magicians, they're actually, using the power of thought.
They're manipulators, aren't they? So it's a difficult one, that, as to what exactly is prestidigitation and what actually is mind over matter, because they clearly have some ability to influence thought processes, either it's mesmerically, hypnotic, however you want to call it. And they've developed these capacities which are currently beyond the evolution of the average person.
Yeah. Did you see that one where David Blaine, he sews up his mouth in front of David Beckham and his son. He sews up his mouth, and these frogs start coming out of his sewn up mouth into his hand.
No, they're amazing, Darren Brown and David Blaine. They're the hidden masters that have revealed themselves, because they've really taken control of their concentration.
Is that illusion, or is that mind over matter, or what?
I can't really explain.
They turn to the dark side.
It's like there are things that they're still not fully explained. Clever Hans, the horse that could possibly have been psychic, about 1905.
I know that story, but
it's still not explained how it was done. This horse could count, and he was psychic.
But the stuff they do these days, and I just watch it, and I think, how on earth do they do it? How on? Because they'll be in the, in the streets, and they'll just levitate in the streets.
He showed that, but still, the explanation still didn't sort of add up. I haven't watched any of this stuff for ages. But,
no, I haven't, not for a while. I just saw this.
But it is impressive, and it's a new stage in magic, or conjuring, or stage, being a stage magician. Then what was that other guy called? You like this a lot, but...
Dynamo.
I don't know him.
Shall we get on with the...
But it is about thought power, really. It's connected to...
This is the last bit.
Can I say ideas of being powerful?
So
is there a suggestion that thought has moved a gram of something 1 inch?
If that's possible, then we clearly are evolving. we are developing these faculties. And there are people in the vanguard of this.
Is there any proven instance that this has occurred?
No, there are people who are there already who already have this power, but we, for most of us, we still don't work, you know, it's some way off.
We just can't do it.
That's it, we can't do it. okay, Leadbeater's clairvoyant work on thought forms. Now, it's been disputed, but they could work out what thoughts look like, and this is quite controversial. But they did work on chemical elements of the periodic table, basically looking at atoms, and their work was found by the 1950s to have been years ahead of its time. Cognitive thought. Leadbeater really worked on colour, the form and the clearness of the thought. That was what they were looking for. Three classes of thought form: take on the image of the thinker, take on the image of some material form, and take on a form of entirely of its own. So that came in that category. Now, there's a key to the colours. In fact, this is available. I've got this. Anyone wants to download this and study this? Every emotion has a corresponding colour. Okay.
Where did you get that from, Dave, the colours and the emotions?
Can we see it a little bit longer so we can read them all?
Okay.
So
this
where's it from?
C.W. Leadbeater and Anibescent's Thought Forms.
All right, okay.
So do they correspond to the chakras?
Some of them do.
Some of them do. They took it a bit further than that.
Some of them are just shades, aren't they, when you look at sympathy and adaptability. They're so similar.
That's right.
That poor man's got a problem with his body, isn't he?
Yes, I demand my money back if I had a body like that. Okay, move on. Sustained anger and murderous rage. Well, there we are. Sports of anger.
I think that looks pretty.
Yeah.
Handsome.
But clearly, not just explosive anger, not directed at anybody. So the previous one is clearly directed at somebody.
Yeah.
Where that thunderbolt's going, you know. Angry jealousy, the pointy bits coming off. That's true, yes. That's a good point, though, yes. Watchful jealousy, it's a sneaky one, that one.
That's really hard to define.
Yeah. Selfish greed, notice the hooks on that.
It's like a hand.
Yeah, like a hand, yeah. Selfish greed, there we are.
Read books on it.
Greed for drink. Oh, yes.
Because of the t-shirt.
At least you got a pink.
Theosophy postulates that when you die, you're just the same as you were when you're alive. You don't have a physical body. And if you're desperate for a drink when you're alive, you'll be desperate for a drink when you're dead, and you won't have a body to drink it with.
So where did he get these images from?
He said he claimed to be clairvoyant.
He's clairvoyant, yeah.
Oh, that's...
Best and Leadbeater to work together. And this is controversial because some people say this is tosh. But
yeah,
an experience, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, an offering.
Yeah, it's an offering. But the work on with the periodic table and looking at atoms were perhaps ahead of its time. Anyway, it's ideas. But I mean, that greed for drink...
Quite interesting. I was doing an art course, and the tutor played some different types of material of music, and we had to draw what the music did to our brain. You know, and it was amazing how alike all the pictures were.
Mm.
They were,
What, the same colours?
Yeah, same colours, the same zigzags or you know, sharp bits of food.
I can understand that, you know, it's sort of very aggressive type music, you would have lots of things there. But those pictures are so specific, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You've got that Dr. Demoto, haven't you, the water guy?
Oh, yes.
And
you
stick love on a bottle, it'll change its molecular structure, and if you play it sort of black metal, it'll sort of become really disturbed, and don't know why. But,
yeah, that was wrong with heavy metal.
Black metal, okay.
Black metal, yes.
Worshipping Satan.
Yes.
But those are only pictures of what they imagine. You can, you know, do your own pictures.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Mm.
Yeah. No. High ambition. Actually, that looks very like the drink one, only white.
Got more fingers, hasn't it?
It has, got a lot of fingers. Finger in every pie.
Yeah, someone else has one.
Sudden fright. Explosion of movement.
That's lovely. That's
rather pretty, that.
Yeah.
Intention to know. Inquiring mind.
Curiosity.
Yes.
That looks like two eyes.
Well, they say to worm something out of someone.
It's true.
What's been the black bit in the back? He made a mistake, though, did he?
I don't know. I think that is a jotting on the corner of the page. Appreciation of a picture.
That's what they saw. That's what they saw.
And where are these from?
C.W. Annie Besant and C.W. Leadbeater's thought forms.
What
one? Yeah. Definite affection.
Cheers.
Or meeting a friend. That's a smile, isn't it?
Yes.
Devotion and response. That's very focused, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Hopeful thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Like that character.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Uncle, what's his name?
Yeah, that's right.
No, cousin somebody, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Cousin Ed?
Yes.
It's in the six directions. I don't really know what to put that in for, whether that's...
That's what they thought of when they saw
six directions. Love for all, there we are.
That's the one we should be looking for.
Peace and protection, that's a dove. Mm. Penguins. Self-renunciation, that's in the lotus.
That's the best one. Put the folks on the end. That's
all.
That's
funny, yeah.
Yeah.
Should
that's
have
thought
some biscuits at the same time.
That true desire principle.
Here we go.
Plain chocolate biscuits for me.
At the moment I'm reading a book about Krishnamurti and in the book it says that Leadbeater at that time, it was really Morton on these things to do was to reinvent yourself, and Leadbeater apparently he reinvented himself.
He certainly needed to, did Leadbeater, yeah. yes, it's a very...
Yeah, he worked on that.
Yeah.
Why do you say that? What was his life like?
Right, okay. Leadbeater, and it's rather unfortunate, he, through his period in the Theosophical Society, there are a number of allegations that he was a paedophile. He eventually resigned from the Theosophical Society because he was bringing the society bad publicity, but he was never prosecuted.
Wow.
And there's another side to the story there, that Krishnamurti's father started it because he didn't like the way that he trained Krishna.
What, started the rumour?
Well, yes, started the rumour and allegations and everything, though it never went to court.
Leadbeater took over Krishnamurti as a student when he was 9 and brought him up as the new world teacher, which Krishnamurti later rejected.
Mm-hmm.
And now Krishnamurti has never spoken on this, but Krishnamurti's father accused Leadbeater of interfering with Krishnamurti.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And that was never went to court and it was never proved. But there were apparently there were some other allegations as well to do with choir boys. But again, he was never prosecuted. So the matter remains open.
Are you saying that that was the only way that he reinvented himself?
No, I was just saying
I know that was one of the things. They don't actually, in the book, they don't actually say how he reinvented himself. Or was it actually he reinvented himself to be in the position he was in the Theosophical Society and also taking into consideration where he came from as a child?
Unfortunately, Leadbeater got rather a hard time, along with James Ingall Wedgwood, founders of the Liberal Catholic Church.
Ah.
They were both gay. And they were ministers in the Church of England. They resigned from the Church of England just ahead of being up in front of some tribunal for being gay. This was a problem in 1914. No one had bothered now.
Mm.
Anyway, they started their own church, which is still going today, the Liberal Catholic Church.
Mm.
But I think that was another thing with Leadbeater, that he was gay, and so was the other, James Ingall Wedgwood. And I think they got a hard time over that as well.
Well, yeah, obviously, because, you know, it wasn't legal at the time.
Yeah, that's
so you
right.
Sort of understand all
we're talking 100 years ago.
Yeah, and the repression and all of that they had to... Well, I noticed that he died a year after Annie Besant.
That's right, yeah.
So
yes,
I
that's
just
right.
wondered about that, really, because, you know, like they say, when one...
Well, no, they were quite old. They were in the both in their 80s. Hang on, we got the dates for them both.
1933 and 1934.
Yeah, that's just how old they actually were.
Mm.
Just a minute, find my glasses again. Because they were for the period they were incredibly old.
I think the story of Alan Turing. What a sad story.
Mm. Oh yeah.
Oh my God! You know, he solved the Enigma code, saved millions of people. And then he gets chemically castrated and he commits suicide.
There was someone on the radio saying it was that the police had it injured. Once he found, oh, it's a university professor who's homosexual, oh, well, have him. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, it's absolutely disgusting.
Mm-hmm. You'll make Rob Proctor in there. Right. 1847 to 1933, so that makes. I think Annie Besant was at 85 or 86, and Leadbeater was 80.
Yeah,
so for the period of in those days, that was old.
Yeah.
The average life expectancy was about 23 then, wasn't it? Average life expectancy for men when they brought in pensions in 1910 was 47.
Wow.
So we've moved on a bit since then.
Could you look at all the old gravestones in churches and from around that time, they're all in their 80s and so on, aren't they?
I don't know
how that works out.
I think it's to do with whether your family were better off. My grandfather talked about this, that what you did for a living affected how long you lived for. It's around the turn of the century.
It's still the same, isn't it?
It's still the same. Not to the extent it was, though. But he said a factory worker couldn't expect to live beyond about 50, whereas a school teacher, a civil servant, a bank clerk, or a vicar, they lived a lot, noticeably, considerably longer.
Yes, but factories, I mean, they were breathing in all sorts of disgusting things that killed them, weren't they?
Yeah. But you also could afford a doctor.
Yeah.
That would help. I think the National Health Service has closed the gap a little bit there, that people couldn't afford doctors unless you're reasonably well off.
A lot of people will work to death though, from a very young age.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Because, you know, you say they lived to live 50, but they'd have started work when they were 11 and 12.
That's right, yes. The whole process
was a long time.
Earlier.
I actually think, I don't think we we live longer because we eat better. I actually think if the karma actually exists, is that as we are going along, as we now living longer and longer and longer, and because we've developed an awful lot more karma, so we are coming in, we have to live longer because we got to work out
more to
all
do.
This
yeah. more to work
karma.
Through. Now, Jones,
so, because you,
yeah.
what they're also saying in the books is that when you exhaust your karma, you come into done in this life, then the body falls. And we do have many people, they eat badly, whatever it is, they see the doctor and they suffer from this, that and the other, and all it is because they've not finished their karma.
Yeah, they've
so
got to carry
they've
on.
They've actually got to live their life out in a body they can hardly keep
that's
together.
Right. And actually, James, that's a karma doctor. Well, you come along to have your karma tested. And it's, sorry, mate, you've got to go on for another 20 years.
Anyway, it's just a thought.
Yeah, no, it's a...
Well, Keith Richards is still alive, and he's a spiritual master.
What, Keith Richards?
There's those jokes about Keith Richards.
Oh, yeah.
Keith Richards found alive
Keith
in
Richards
hotel room.
Watch. Looks like he's going to pack up any minute. Been working perfectly for the last 50 years, you know.
What was that about a spiritual... What did you say about Keith Richards and being a spiritual...
I was joking.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
Well, he might, really is to Sam.
Well,
he invented that riff in G,
well,
didn't
that's
he?
True. Now, Joel has an idea, and we have a debate in a few weeks' time, on when, because there's so much, do you want to explain it?
Well, not really, I would rather wait till the night, because
oh.
if we're going to discuss it now,
no,
it would be pointless
to,
doing it
in
a few weeks' time.
I was going to suggest that we do this and then everyone have some ideas for the night.
Mm. Are we not going to, no?
What?
I'd rather throw it at them on the
night. Okay, I'm on the night then. Okay,
yeah.
Joe's got an idea, but
so
we'll hear about
we're
it.
Not going to know what we're going to discuss on the night?
No, Joe has a presentation.
What night is this?
Yeah.
Which
it's
will be then,
day,
with, then be open for discussion.
During the night. It's a special
yeah.
night.
But we're not going to
but
know.
But we're going, no, we're not going to discuss it today.
No, I
when's
don't
it going
think
to happen?
Discuss, but are we not going to know what the discussion is going to be about?
Well, you will do, yes, on the night.
Oh, you're not
A theosophical topic.
Don't want us to have preparation time.
A theosophical
no,
topic.
No, I just...
Have
we cannot
see,
Dave,
you wound everybody up.
No, sorry about
bringing
that.
It
I
up
thought,
too early.
Well, no, I was going to put you down for a 10-minute presentation or whatever. And
what
then,
night is this anyway?
Saturday? I'll come up with a title for it anyway.
Thursday night?
Yeah, is there a title? There going to be a title for it?
Oh, there'll be a title for it. I'll think of one by
yes. Surprise debate.
Pardon?
Surprise debate. That'll be the title.
Can
a controversial theosophical subject.
Yeah,
yeah.
By a student.
A student theosophy will present.
But it's nothing very much. It's not going to take a week to talk about. Or
well, depending on how much comments we make. Can I suggest something for that meeting? When we have our philosophy meetings, is that we also got someone who presented for about the stimulus, we call it, for 10 minutes.
Mm.
And then there is a facilitator, so whenever you want to speak, you've got to put your hand up, and the facilitator takes your name. You can only speak when your name is being called.
Mm.
Now, if somebody else makes a comment and you want to respond to that one as well, not necessarily the speaker, then again, you've got to put up your hand, and then you can, in your comment, you can then say, well, Joe said, and I absolutely disagree with it, or I agree with it. That means that nobody is just bopping in.
Hmm. Well, that's a bit
it's
of a
very
blah,
civilized.
I think we manage quite
well.
We
manage
it. You know, when I heard you say something and Dave didn't hear, I said to Dave, and you were able
but that
to say
wouldn't, that wouldn't occur at all
but
if it's like that. Anyway,
but no, no, I mean, I do my presentations,
yeah.
And anybody can interrupt and put the two pennies in at any time,
yeah, that's
which is why something that would have taken about 20 minutes has lasted nearly 2 hours, but you know, we can work it up.
As long as people respect the fact that if somebody is speaking,
mm.
it's not polite to interrupt or
yeah.
to carry on different conversations at the same time.
I was just going to suggest the way we do it with
philosophy.
But they don't have it. They would rather have this interrupting
No, the way it works at philosophy is fantastic.
It is fantastic.
And it creates, it's more than just, you know, I think it just creates a very caring sort of, isn't it?
Exactly.
And you become aware as well when you're interrupting people.
Yeah.
It creates something.
And
do
you're
people
not
really
being interrupted.
But I mean, I'm speaking with this on the basis that anyone can interrupt me and stop me at any time.
Well, that is
a
different kind of matter.
There's no point in having, giving out, taking
no,
it, you know, just,
well, I think it depends on the nature of the talk.
Because
some talks are more free-flowing than others.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. I think, it depends on the talk. But I think if it's a debate, because...
And we normally have a chairman anyway for debate, because that's somebody...
You need one of those crook things that when if somebody talks too much, you can be dragged out of the room,
pushed
down the stairs.
Another thing as well, you know, having a few crowds is good.
Yeah, theosophical security. Somebody standing by the door in some of the sad Nazi uniform. That'd be good.
Okay, thank you, everybody.
Cheers, Dave.
Or we can do it at like when you're at school.
Right,
yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
Put your hand up.
We had a Ray Emerson once had a
cross.
The
metal
cross.
The talking stick
would be a good idea.
Yeah.
That was a.
I think we're all grown up enough to allow each other to speak.
If anybody's got a flash memory, you can have a copy of the.
Well, I certainly provoked the debate, Dave. Thank you very much for that. Your efforts.
That was
good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
That's all my thinking now.
Take it to a higher level, Rob.
That's where I'm falling down.
Okay.
Too many sort of fingers running.
Can't have a drink when you go to heaven, that's bad. I'm going to have to live forever.